Good evening, everyone. Actually,
Actually,
today
today
we
we
have
have
gathered
gathered
here
here
to
to
start
start
another
another
very
very
important
important
webinar.
webinar.
That
That
is,
is
today
today
our
our
topic
topic
is
is
Drive
Drive Smart,
Smart, Save
Save
Lives,
Lives,
and
and
Role
Role
of Civil Engineers
of
in
in Road Safety. This is a very important topic, which is the webinar is organized by Civil Engineering Sectional Committee. There is a bit of a history for this webinar because some time back, after getting various statistics with regard to road safety, we all felt that as the Civil Engineering Sectional Committee, that we should do something for road safety as civil engineers. So as a result of that, with the leadership of Chairman of Civil Engineering Sectional Committee, we arranged our first, we conducted our first event that was a road safety awareness program to general public, which was conducted last month, actually near to Ottawa Interchange, distributing a lot of leaflets, at the same time, some of the stickers to general public. So from that point, then we felt as the sectional committee, we wanted to go ahead with more awareness sessions. So as a result of that, we today gather here to conduct this webinar. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a very important occasion, and I would like to welcome all of you. At the same time, I would like to welcome our very experienced panel members for today's webinar. Let me introduce our panel members. We have a very eminent as well as experienced panel members here today gathered. First of all, let me introduce Professor J.M.S.J. Bandara, Senior Professor, Department of Civil Engineering, Head of Transportation Engineering Division, Director, Center of Intelligent Transport System, University of Marutu, Sri Lanka. At the same time, Engineer R.M. Amarasekara, Rural Road Specialist, Road Project RDA, former Director Planning RDA, former Additional Director General RDA, former Additional Director General Asset Management RDA. And also we have Engineer Nihal Vikramaratne, Traffic Engineering Consultant, former Director Engineering Traffic Design and Rural Road Safety, CMC, former Deputy Municipal Commissioner, Engineering Division. With those panel members, we have lead panelists. Actually, he will be moderating the session. Engineer Dr. Loshak Pereira, Senior Lecturer, Department of Civil Engineering, Transportation Engineering, University of Marutu, Sri Lanka. So I hope that with that introduction, we can start our webinar. Before that, I would like to invite all of you, if you have any questions or queries with regard to the webinar or the topic, you can send to our chat box. You can see that there is a moderator co-host there. So you have to direct your questions to this moderator. After that, we will be able to discuss these questions during our webinar. Please note that there's no specific time period allocated for questions. During the webinar, we will be able to discuss your questions. With that, I will hand over the session to our moderator, Dr. Loshak Pereira, to commence this webinar. Doctor, over to you.
Thank you, Engineer Tirak. Thank you very much for the introduction. And first of all, I would like to warmly welcome the three lead panelists to this discussion. And as our secretary, Mr. Engineer Tilak, explained, I would like to brief first the objective of this seminar series. As a sectional committee, we have started a road safety program a couple of months back. And we have lined up a few actually, I would say, programs in line with, you know, looking at different users and their perspective, how to improve the road safety in Sri Lanka. Because day to day, you can see number of crashes are, you know, very high, and there are a lot of victims and, you know, a lot of fatalities and so on. So if you look at the crash contributors and factors, there are many parties involved, not only the drivers, but also passengers, as well as pedestrians. And there are other stakeholders as well. So it is a very broad thing that we are talking about. So it is not sufficient. I mean, a day or two will not be really sufficient enough to talk about all these things. So like, therefore, we have decided, we have our program is focused on different aspects on different days. So this seminar series is mainly focused on the engineer's responsibility. We can see the engineers, I mean, when you look at the engineer's point of view, there's a greater responsibility towards improving safety or the maintaining road safety. And this discussion is mainly towards that. So this is not a single seminar, and we are planned to conduct, you know, series of seminars. So this will be the introduction point where we can discuss the road aspect of the engineer's responsibility. And in future seminar series, we will be going in detail and talking more, I would say, engineering-related aspects, such as designing, I mean, geometric designing, traffic management, and things like that in very detail. So today, we have, as engineers Tilak suggested, or rather mentioned, we have three eminent resource persons here. So I would like to ask the first question as an ice-breaking question from all three panelists. Because there's a very, I mean, popular accident we have all seen in last, I would say, few weeks or rather few weeks ago that has happened in Pasar. And actually, in my opinion, these accidents are happening most of the time in many places in around the Sri Lanka. And the thing is, we really get not, I mean, these accidents are not really get noticed because, I mean, there is no much evidence and so on. But this particular accident was really focused or, I mean, attracted big attention because there's a good CCTV footage which shows exactly what has happened. So I think that is why this particular accident has, you know, come to that sort of effect in the, I would say, in the society. So let me start with that and as ice-breaking point. And let me ask from Mr. Amarasekara first. In your opinion, what do you think? Who would be the most responsible party in this particular accident when you look at the CCTV footage?
Yes, no, straight answer is just, I think, to begin with. Of course, there was a problem of rock falling and then obstructing the roadway. And also the tipper driver, he was just passing that place and he posed a bit. And then another driver, he was coming very fast and he was taking it to grant that the tipper driver will pass that place so that he can go through. So he has misjudged, and then this tipper driver unexpectedly he posted a little, maybe because of the other man's other person's speed. So all in all, everybody is responsible: road authority, the tipper driver, and the bus driver. In my point of view, but of course it occurred because there was some obstruction on the road. So what are the other two also there? But of course, it's the most important thing is there was obstruction. It is not occurred just a minute ago or 1 hour ago. It has been there for quite some time, which we know. So on the part of the people who have been responsible to maintain the road, they have not done their part. So from that point of view, of course, they have not shouldered their responsibility. The contractor, I mean, this road have been under construction, and then this contract was not over. It's under defect liability also. And then the construction engineer is responsible, and there's a supervision consultant and a road authority itself. And also the police and general public also responsible in a way. They should have pressurized this authority. There's obstruction you should remove, like buses and other. So all in all, everybody is responsible, but of course, people who have suffered is really suffered of no fault of theirs. So this is the fate of it. Now, most of the accidents, the people who meet in the accident, sometimes they are not responsible for the accident, but of course they are victims. So it's pathetic. So I mean, most of them have not performed up to their expectation.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Amarasekara. What do you think, Mr. Nihar? What do you think about this incident?
Well, looking at the incident, I would like to share my thoughts as equal responsibility by all parties. You can't single out the engineer's fault, because probably you saw in the footage that, you know, the speeds that the bus was traveling. And the tipper driver had some judgmental issues, because he just went to the obstruction and stopped. If he had passed through, actually, the speed that he was traveling, if he has passed that obstruction, probably the bus would have saved. On the other part of it, you know, I don't know whether, because fatigue cannot be a reason, driver fatigue cannot be a reason for this, because they started from Pastara, and it was a very short distance, in a short distance that, you know, this issue happened. So, the driver's negligence is more than anything, because he was driving in reckless speed, and that is usual. You know, Pastara, Colombo, Badulla, Colombo buses, you know, when we drive, you know, you can see what speeds that they travel in, because they are so much familiar with the bends, they're familiar with the roads, you know, but, you know, he has misjudged this point that, you know, there is obstruction. But sad to say that, you know, as engineers, you know, we also have a issue, because there is an oversight from our side, from the engineer's point of view. I don't know what internal institutional issues has been there, to be fair, by the engineer's side, because whether there was no enough funds, or, you know, the contractor was absurd, and, you know, he was not responding to the request. I don't know what really happened. You know, at least some, even if the rock cannot be removed, but some precautionary measures should have been taken. So I would share the responsibility among all of them, but you can't from the engineer's responsibility.
Thank you, Mr. Nihal, and I would like to know the opinion of the Professor Samant Bandara as well.
Well, it's very clear that there are so many parties that we can put the blame on. But the question is, by just putting the blame to one party, will this problem solve for future? That is what we have to think. Because we know that there are certain facts that related to crashes. There are number of enabling factors that are required for a crash to happen. So in this case, we saw the rock that has fallen as one of the main factors. But in addition, there can be some other factors as well. But what is important is that any crash to happen, there should be some kind of a human error involved. At least a small human error. Because of that, only an accident will happen, or crash will happen. So here, I think from both parties, I think we can see from the videos some kind of an error has occurred. And that error is actually related to the attitude of. So what I can see from that is that both drivers have thought that the other person will stop. So that is the attitude. When you usually drive a bigger vehicle, you think that the other one will stop and give way for me. So for me, the main reason is that. And also, there's another very interesting, theory in the sense that, you know, usually these type of accidents or accident crashes happen either at the beginning of the trip or at the very end of the trip, because your concentration level is slightly different from, you know, middle part of the trip. Now, there is another question. Yes, we can blame somebody, but the excessive speed. Now, whether this vehicle was speeding only at this point or whether it was speeding from the beginning. So those are the things that we need to look at. And when you are thinking about any future action, we have to consider these as well, not only what happened at the site. So that is what I think. So it has happened, and that got the limelight because of the number of casualties as well as because of the video footage available. But there are so many other crashes happening elsewhere which will not get the same attention. But overall, we have to look at it in a different way. Yeah, it's true that we have to find reason and responsible party, but there is something beyond that. Especially the engineering community can keep it. So that's what I think.
Okay, thank you. If I can conclude the three answers given by the three panelists, three members, I think there are multiple factors that have contributed toward, I would say, in general crashes as well as this particular crash. So engineering aspect or engineer's responsibility is also there, that has been mentioned by all three panelists, I think. And on top of that, there are different other factors that we are talking about. So as I mentioned before, there are many things that we can talk about, but since today's focus is more about the engineers, I would like to start from the engineer's responsibility. So let me ask the next question from the Mr. Amarasekhar, basically who has decades of experience in the road industry. So Mr. Amarasekhar, could you please explain us what is the responsibility of an engineer towards road safety? When you look at the road sector, basically construction and as well as operation and maintenance as well. There's I think a significant portion of responsibility lies with the engineer to maintain the road safety up to the standard or maybe beyond that. So what do you think, what is the responsibility of engineer and how responsible engineers can improve the road safety condition of Sri Lanka?
Yeah. To answer the question, let me give you a background. You may be aware, but of course, let me summarize so that the answer is straightforward.
Please.
The roads in Sri Lanka, there are various roads. And there are various road authorities who are responsible to do the maintenance. Now, for example, the national roads, we call it national roads. Those are A and B class roads, are the responsibility of the road development authority. And the expressways also the responsibility of the road development authority. Then come to this CND class roads. So those are the responsibilities of the provincial councils. And then when it comes to other rural roads, when we come to other rural roads, these Raj Sabhas, municipal councils, urban council, and those authorities are responsible for construction maintenance of these roads. So all in all, there are various parties, and then for the rider, whether it is expressway or whether it is a provincial council road and whether it's a Pranjaba road, they don't know. They will be going and then, so responsibilities are divided. And then when we talk about A and B class roads, those are national roads. Of course, majority of the traffic carries on these roads and expressways. So they are managed, well managed with an engineering organization, which is Road Development Authority. And there are various divisions created for sharing the responsibility. They have a fairly organized organization covering the whole of the country. In the province is headed by a provincial director, and then district is headed by another chief engineer, and then district is divided into either two or three divisions, which are managed by another executive engineer. So these engineers are responsible for day-to-day maintenance and then upkeep of these roads. And then maintenance only doesn't look after the road, safety of the road users. That is, they can do only what is constructed, and then what is the existing asset only they can do the maintenance. Of course, these certain things like earth slips, rock falls, and then maybe a broken culvert or potholes, and then maybe clearing the clearing the vegetation and having a clear sight distance. All these are day-to-day routine maintenance, and then periodicals also, they have something to do, color washing, and then see that road signs and markings are maintained. So I think if we compare it, what was there about 20 years ago, 2000 or 2005, now it's quite improved. And the road itself, those were constructed long time back, maybe 100 years ago, and then road geometry was to suit the occasion, I mean, the situation at that time. Now, since we started from 2005 or so, quite amount of road improvements has been done. Of course, there were restrictions on how much land you have and how much the geometric standards that you can follow and all that is there. But at least about 65% of the roads have been made to two-lane facility. And if you know, if you go back and see to 1986 or so, when the Road Development Authority started its function, the number of two-lane kilometers was less than 200 kilometers. So whereas now, out of 12,000 kilometers, now 65% even more than that is two-lane or above. So that means roads have been improved. Surface condition has been improved. And road marking, now it's there and it's maintained. And the road signs are there, they are maintained. So there's quite an organization. Their responsibility, I think, is looked after as a corporate responsibility of the Road Development Authority. Engineers may, one engineer may be responsible and then he may be getting transferred, retired and all that. But of course, it must be an organization culture that proper maintenance, day-to-day maintenance and upkeep of the road is looked after. I think there's quite a responsibility there. And when it comes to these rural roads, we are still lacking the maintenance, road signs and marking and upkeep. Of course, now a lot of effort have been taken. They are taking place also in the local government ministry under some aided project. They are cultivating the culture of maintaining these assets. So I think in time to time, it will improve. But the engineers, not only by their job description, but of course, there must be a personal attitude also, as he said, the attitudinal changes also that they have to see they are in charge of quite a big amount of asset and then also quite a amount of their citizens of this country is using, and then any fault, any lapse in the responsibility will cause to make accidents. As you correctly said in the previous example, the road safety is not only the road, but of course there are other parties and various conditions. So road responsibility of the road authority is of course is in a higher percentage, but of course there are other parties involved for improving the road safety. What I could say now, for engineers' responsibility, I think now more and more it's becoming aware and they are doing a good job than what we had. From government point of view also, they have taken a lot of interest in investing for road maintenance. Funds are available and also for construction improvement also is there. But given the condition of the country, roadside friction, there are quite a amount of roadside buildings constructed, access to each and every adjoining land. So this is causing some side frictions and then cause to accident. These are coming via the inherited from the what we had from colonial rule, and then after that we have not taken action to maintain a clear right of way. So right of way is mostly they are encroached. So this is also causing, which is beyond the engineer's responsibility to a certain extent. So these factors are not engineering, but of course use the land use and other things, which is responsible of the local government, UDA, and then maybe provincial council, who gives authority for construction of these buildings. And if one or three constructions are there to remove them, all that is also contributing to this road safety.
Okay, I think we have a lot more questions to ask from Mr. Amarasekara, but we can keep them for the towards the end maybe. And with that, I think I should ask a similar question from Mr. Nihal as well. Having again, you know, many number of years of experience in the Colombo Municipal Council, mainly in the traffic management sector. And can you please share your thoughts on the road safety with respect to the traffic management? For example, especially with the road maintenance work that are going on, and you know, there are, you can see many instances, there are new services projects are implemented and so on. So there are a lot of work zones and, you know, interruptions to traffic at the most of the time within the Colombo municipal limit. So we have a lot of experience with that, managing these IPing projects and issues as well. So could you please elaborate us, you know, with respect to the traffic safety, I mean, engineer's responsibility with respect to the traffic safety?
Yeah, I'm more of a urban sector road. My experience has been in that field. I think I'm Samarasekara is different. But to say that, you know, I have worked in the Colombo Municipal Council and we maintain and rehabilitate 480 kilometers of road network. So that's my part of the experience. Anyway, looking at, you know, I think, you know, the safety aspect has to be looked at the looked at first while you are doing the designs. If you miss something, you know, it's very difficult to rectify. So, but having said that, you know, we have to accept that, you know, the fact that this safety culture is not that much built into our engineers, you know, whether it's personal safety or, you know, accident safety is something that is not given that much of priority. So I think time has come that we have to, you know, inculcate a culture so that, you know, or some kind of a mandatory requirement that, you know, a design goes through some safety audit procedure, and also to do with, you know, some safety audit later on. But having said that, you know, I have worked in an organization where, you know, recruitment of the required engineers was that much difficult because it doesn't provide in the cadres, you know, getting the card numbers increases quite a different task. But there are, you know, the topic is smart, right? So I think there are a lot of things that engineers can think new. For an example, if you take a crossing, right, and if there is a pedestrian crossing, there's a switch that you press for a person to cross the road. But often he presses and, you know, look both sides, and if there is no vehicle, he just cross the road. He doesn't wait for the his green light, the walking green light to come in. And at end of the day, the vehicle comes and sees that the light is red. And, you know, he just crosses in the red light. You know, this happens often. But smartness is that, you know, engineers create something different. Now, for an example, I think the Colombo Municipal Council sometime back had this issue right throughout. And we started with the traffic lights, pelican crossings installed. But just pressing the button and getting his cycle to cross the road won't do. His image also has to be captured to say that he is still there. So that physical red light for the passing traffic will come, provided that his image is also captured. So those are simple things that, you know, we did with some local instrumentation. These are small things that, you know, engineers, you know, you can think about. But looking at the same time, you know, sometimes the public who uses the road also don't know the regulation. Now, there are a couple of times that you have to give statements to the police in an intersection where there is shared light to turn into a by road in an intersection. If you don't have the green light with the arrow, or, you know, which means that, you know, you have to, the driver also has to check, be careful that, you know, some other lane, when they see, you know, some other driver can see the gap and, you know, do a turn, right? So these things are not, I don't know how to educate people, but, you know, not known to many of the drivers, right? So there, very often, you know, this kind of accidents happen. And also, now looking at the urban issue in the night time, you know, pedestrians crossings are very vulnerable. I mean, you could see a lot of black spots, except in some of the main roads, there are a lot of black spots. So you can, you know, install a light to illuminate the pedestrian crossing, right? These are some of the things that, you know, council and the RDA has already done, but yet more to be done. because in the night, you know, it's so vulnerable that the pedestrians, you know, sometimes, you know, our pedestrians also, you know, have a phone on one ear and, you know, talk to somebody and at the same time cross the road, right? So if there is some glare by oncoming vehicle, he will not see the pedestrian. So these are some of the things that, you know, as engineers, you know, we all should get together and think something smart, I would say. And with regard to the excavations, as you rightly said, you know, there is a big need of augmentation of utilities, power sector, sewerage, because these are old cities. And with the development, there is a need for augmentation, and it's happening at different times. A lot of people, you know, there's a lot of criticism of, you know, roads being dug up very often, but you know, working in the agency, we know the difficulty that, you know, funds don't come in the right time, and you know, some certain things get staggered, and you know, you can't incorporate all the services before rehabilitating a road. But having said that, you know, it's general that, you know, in a tender, we don't emphasize much on the safety side. Now, in preambles, you know, in the preliminaries, you know, there will be certain items to manage traffic, you know, secure safety and things like that. But often they are undercoated, I would say, right? And not much of, you know, attention is given by the bidder. So when it comes to implementation, there is very little money in safety matters. So even if that gets chopped off by the engineer to the contract, you know, there is not much of an effect, because that's not a big lump, right? And also most of the contracts, you know, if you don't, punitive action also in that. So what the contractor loses is only the amount that is quoted by him. So I would suggest that, you know, all engineers to, you know, give some thought to this, and, you know, at least make some allowance in the BOQ, so that, you know, and to make a condition that, you know, they can't quote anything below this specified value. I don't know contractually how we can do that, but it's something that, you know, if some amendments can be made to the contract forms, that can be done. So that's something that, you know, I have seen in a lot of places.
Okay, I think maybe that opens up so many questions, but again, we can give the opportunity to the audience as well. We'll take a couple of questions after a little while, not right now. At the same time, let me move on to the Professor Saman Bandara, and I would like to ask, as a person who has done a lot of research on road safety and who has involved in a lot of road safety related projects and so on, what do you think about the engineer's responsibility? I would ask this question in two directions. One is with respect to the road construction and maintenance, and then the traffic management. What do you think, Professor Bandara, in your opinion, what is the engineer's responsibility in these two aspects?
Yeah, to answer your question short, you know, yeah, it is the responsibility. But elaborating on that, as Kamal said, our road sector has been rolled over quite a long time. And the geometry especially, we have created the geometry for the vehicles at that time, not the vehicles now. So as engineers, we have to come up with some mechanism to make sure that the safe speeds can be maintained. Because there is a contradictory side to this as well, because our Motor Traffic Act specifies only two sets of speeds, 70 and 50. And that also you have to gather the coordinate of the section from here to somewhere else. So the drivers or the road users have a misconception that, okay, if you leave 50, you can go at 70 kilometers per hour. Whereas most of the stretch in this 70 kilometer per hour area, you can't go at 70 kilo, not even 50 kilometers per hour. So first thing is that, you know, the engineer should be able to figure out what is the safe speed. Especially the civil engineers will be able to do that. Not the people who have done only economics and things like that. Right? You need to have the civil engineering background. The gradients, the conditions, and you know, all these aspects has to be considered. And we have to have a mechanism that, you know, the speed limits can be, you know, shown as a you know, regulatory sign where the appropriate speed can be posted. I think Somerset tried hard sometimes back to get it done, but unfortunately, still that could RDA was not successful in getting that, because that misconception is one of the reasons why people are traveling very far. So engineers should be able to figure it out. And now, in the absence of that provision in the Motor Traffic Act, in the design itself, as the engineer Nihal said, you know, in the design itself, you can incorporate some calming measures, especially at the curves and the gradient, so that all the vehicles will have you know, safer speed that will be maintained without giving unnecessary overconfidence to the driver. And then when it comes to the construction period, it's a very simple thing that you have to do is that, you know, some warning sign. But as we have mentioned that most of the contractors do not pay that much of attention, because they have a misconception that, you know, when you put all these signs, there are no accidents, and they consider it as a waste of resources. So actually, why there are no accidents is because of those the signs and markings. They don't realize. With the signs and markings, if the accidents are happening, you know, crashes are happening, then there's a serious issue. So you get a feeling that, you know, you put the signs, there are no accidents, so next project, you tend to neglect that part. I think as engineers, we may have to, like, you know, the project sites, they have to insist on these aspects, even for the slightest maintenance work. So if you travel on the expressway, you can see, right? It's the slightest thing, they mark, you know, fairly longer distances. Because, yeah, you know, if something happens, you know it's great. So that culture has to be brought in for any road construction. Right? So once you have your set of movable signs and markings or signs, you know, there is no additional cost. Only thing is, you know, the attitude or the how we look at it. So that is when it comes to construction. And when it comes to traffic management, once again, you know, what traffic management measure that you should use is an engineer's fault, not anybody else's fault. Because the road is constructed by engineer, maintained by engineer, so he's the person who knows how to manage it. But unfortunately, in our country, you know, engineers take the back. You know, in this aspect, they just you know, shy away with, you know, proposing traffic management measures. There can be two reasons. One is the other parties are dominating. The second is that even the civil engineers, they will not have sufficient knowledge in that aspect, because when you take the undergraduate curriculum, there are so many things to be covered. So you can't teach everything to everybody. So that may be another reason. So we have to look at it. So what happens is, those who do not have fundamental knowledge in civil engineering and how the road behaves, and come and tell how to manage, and creating so many problems, so many unsafe problems. So these are the things that you know, civil engineers must take control of. Because to design the road, if you construct the road, if you are maintaining the road, you have to manage the road as well. So that is my view.
I think it is quite clear that engineers, especially the civil engineers, has a greater responsibility towards this road safety, or rather improving the road safety, or the maintaining the road safety at the standard level. I think with that, I would like to ask, or rather, I would like to put it this way now, since this is an internal discussion, which is shared among the members only, I think it is okay to, you know, review ourselves, you know, and talk more about our mistakes, because if we do not talk about ourselves, and there is no chance for us to, you know, correct them. So I think we have freedom to talk about our mistakes and come up with a plan how we're going to, you know, improve these things in the future, at least to, you know, save more lives in the future. So with that, I would like to again turn towards Mr. Amarasekhar and ask now, in your answer, the previous answer, it was really mentioned that, of course, RDE is a very well established and very organized organization, but now when we do the accident data analysis, we have seen that A class, B class road basically belongs to RDE, and there are many crashes happen on A class and B class road. Of course, I understand that is something to do with exposure as well. When you compare to the other roads and indoor traffic, when you look at the A class and B class road, but anyway, when you look at the numbers, there are big numbers and there are major accident, minor accident. There are a lot of accidents happening on B class and A class and B class national level roads. So in that aspect, as a responsible organization, what sort of action basically you take when there's a particular accident? Let's say there's a fatal accident, not necessarily be a popular one, you know, if there's a fatal accident sort of a thing, what sort of actions are be taken at the institutional level in order to, you know, maybe do further investigation to make sure whether there's a engineers, you know, responsibility lacks, or I mean, whether there's something wrong with the road design and so on, because we can talk about many things, you know, geometric design and other aspects and the road conditions and so on. I don't know, I mean, at this particular point, we don't want to go into that detail, which we'll save for the next, you know, upcoming sessions. But I need an answer from your side, you know, in general, what sort of actions have been taken to correct these things? Because it might happen, it happened today, and if we do not take any corrective measures, the problem is still there, and it could happen in tomorrow and in the future. Adding a little bit to that, you know, when you look at the crash data, in general, crash database, the real problem really cannot be encountered by a police officer, to be honest. If there's an engineer's, you know, mistake, or if there's any issue with the engineering aspect, the police officer can't really, take that into account. He can't really observe or see that problem. So as a result, it won't come to the form as well. So as a result, in the crash database, it might not really highlight the road crash, road contribution from the road to the given crash. So keeping those in mind, you know, I just try to, you know, give this information to the audience as well. So with that, I would like to ask the question again, and as a responsible organization, RDA, and what sort of action plan is there to correct these problems?
I think you have come to the crux of the matter here. So as I told you earlier, when the road rehabilitation and improvements take place, of course, there's a road safety audit, and we identify black spots and where to improve, what kind of measures to be taken for improving this road safety. All that is done at the planning stage, and at the design stage also it is taken. So, and it is constructed and put to use. After that, now this, when during the course of construction, there's some road safety, as Mr. Vikramachi said, engineer Vikramachi said, So those are another factor. Now you are asking in general the existing roads which are in under serving, and what kind of actions we take during when accidents happen, whether it get reported to the maintenance engineer. No, it is not getting reported. So this is one of the key, that is why I said it's crux of the matter. So when accidents happens on the road, it's reported to the police, and then it is not reported to the maintenance engineer or the engineer who's in charge of that roads, like executive engineer, chief engineer, provincial director. So they don't have accident database. And then of course, of their own, when they know that several accidents are happening, it's a hearsay or somebody is telling, and then in under investigation of some other station, other occasion, when they get to know that a lot of accidents are happening in that place, of course they do go and do a road safety audit and try and improve. I have been serving in the field as the executive engineer, chief engineer, provincial director for about 26 years before I came to head office as data planning. So there I know this is not reported. Even now, to get for a study, even to go and collect accidents which are happening, that's a very tedious one. You know, it is not there, it is not available to the road engineer, maintenance engineer. So this is lacking, which we have to do something so that maintenance engineers aware these accidents are happening on the daily basis or weekly basis or monthly basis, and some basis we should get the data, accidents are happening on roads under my custody at these places. So then we can go and investigate. There's a problem in the road or road geometry or other road safety measures that we can take to say break the speed or improve the sight distance, or whether it is surface something, water stagnating or something like that. This information is not there. So it is, I think, all what we do now is the ingenuity or interest of the maintenance engineer. When it gets reported from elsewhere, they go and attend to it. Or of their own, they see there's it's a potential accident case, and they go and do that. There's a scheme to identify, we call it black spot. Many accidents are reported. It comes from somebody. There's a lot of accidents happening here. So there was a time that we go and put up board also. Something like that. So these are initiated from the police because they are the people who have the accident record. These are not shared. So this is something that we have to, this is a matter that we have to do. We have been trying to share this. But of course, they came out with a lot of, legal issues and kind of thing. And this information not readily available. It may be even Nihal might witness how much it happened. Unless a police officer comes and says, so there are a lot of accidents happening in this place, of his own, or if he's interested or something. But there's no official procedure to do that. So it's lacking. It's the crux of the matters to improve the safety of roads or improve the black spots. This should get reported to the maintenance engineer. As I told you, there are quite a number of engineers now. It's quite a large number. Provincial directors, there are 9 or 10 provincial directors and 24 chief engineers and about 52 executive engineers. And more than that, there are a lot of other RD engineers responsible. There are a lot of projects going on. So they don't get this. They don't get this information. So this is lacking. We have to do something. We did something in 2006 with the road safety improvement with the Shwedi State when we are doing southern transport development project. Of course, that system was handed over to the police, and the understanding was we hand it over to police to manage, and the university and the road development authority get a link so that we can monitor in real time the accident data. But it never came. This system called MAP, I think now they are improving that also, but we never got it.
Okay, I think it's a bit sad to hear that story or the comment, but that's the truth. So I think we should look at, what is our way forward, how we can, come up with a sustainable solution for this. Let me ask a very quick question before we move on. Now, I think you mentioned the police and the crash database is maintained by the police. And at any point, has RDA, can get this data? Or, can they access the database, not maybe real time, but at least, 1 year, 6 months time, can you get the data? Is there any proper channel to access those things?
there's no standard operation practice, which you call SOR or whatever. There's no standard practice. Of course, when we try to improve roads, when we do road safety audit, we go and ask for that data and we get it, we analyze, and also either it is by a consultant or from RD itself. We go and analyze and then take measures. That is under rehabilitation and improvement, but not during maintenance. So very rarely this exercise is done.
Okay. Engineer Mr. Nihal, I think now the floor is open, you know, the discussion is quite clear now. What do you think when it comes to the Colombo municipal area? I think there were many accidents, you know, with fatalities and so on. Have they been reported to the CMC directly? I mean, in official channel, I would say. And what sort of actions you have taken? First, I would say to investigate what has really happened. And second thing, if there's a problem from the engineer's point of view, and what sort of actions maybe you have taken during your times?
Well, Colombo is a hot spot. You can't shy away from these things. As Amare said, you know, I mean, the accident database is not that much accessible, and it's very difficult to get some information. I'm not blaming the police, though they also must be having some, you know, institutional issues. But having said that, you know, it's an issue that, you know, we can't access the database. But at the same time, when you talk about the urban situation, like the Colombo roads, you know, we generally have a safety meeting once in a month with the police. So all the police OICs, divisional OICs, are called upon for that meeting. And it's been held in the police department itself, and all are required to participate. So we do participate, and there are a lot of issues discussed with regard to safety. So in general, I would say 99% of the issues are addressed, and it is being communicated by the police to the Colombo Municipal Council jurisdiction area issues, because of that meeting, you know, we once a month we have that meeting, and that's so every OIC comes with their issues, and you know, we also have as engineers, we also have issues to tell the police. So a lot of things are, you know, sorted out in those meetings. But having said that, you know, certain things which need capital investment gets delayed, you know, funds have to be allocated for the coming years. And generally, they are addressed in general.
Okay. Even I have attended those meetings sometime back, I can recall. But usually, I mean, those meetings, we talk about general things, you know, general problems and so on. We are not really looking at specifically road accidents and what has really happened, you know, from that point of view, the engineer's point of view, what has led to the accident and so on. But anything, I think there's a greater room for us to improve from the, I mean, as engineers, I would say. And I think I would like to ask a question from Professor Bandara. Now, we started something called Decade of Action Plan in 2011. And as a key person who's been involved in this development of action plan, and now it's been over. Now 2021 was the, this year. And have we achieved the set outcomes? And can you little elaborate on that?
Well, the action plan was started in 2011. With all the stakeholders keeping what they can do and what they have to do. But unfortunately, at that time, there were no outcome indicators specified. So because of that, it is very difficult to say whether we have reached the outcome. But if you look at the numbers, crash numbers, you can see that, you know, the expected outcomes have not been reached. There are a number of reasons, except for one or two stakeholders. Others were not that keen on implementing anything. Right? The exemptions are the Road Development Authority that has done some work, and the Colombo Municipal Council. Other than that, other organizations, probably they do not have sufficient capacity to do that. And 2016, it was updated, considering what has done, taken out, and what to be done included. But there was no follow-up. So that is the status. Coming back to the reporting mechanism, there is a serious shortcoming. The 1996, where the MAP system was introduced, the mechanism to identify the location of accident was manual on a using topo sheet divided into number of cells, and each cell get a coordinate. But recently, police had a problem because they could not upload, or they could not run MAP on new computers. So the whole accident database was redeveloped using latest technology, where now you can incorporate the location using GPS code. And there are two pilot projects, I think, in Colombo and Kennedy, now in operation, the police using a tab to identify the location. So now, there is no big issue sharing the location. I know that police will have a issue sharing all the information related to crash. There are reverse issues and many other things. But you can set up this system to flag locations if a certain number of crashes happen during a specified period of time. And those locations can be very easily shared to relevant organizations. You don't have to share the whole detail, but because what the road authorities required are the locations. And these so-called black spots, there are two types. One is because of the road geometric standards. There are certain black spots created due to visibility issues and things like that. But especially in urban areas, the black spots are actually what people have created, not the road. Where the bus stops have been located, where the pedestrian crossings, and where the there are other non-road related functions created, creating black spots. So those can be identified very easily. And when you visit the site, you can very easily figure out what is the problem. So but to do that, for engineers to do that, they should know the location. That's the whole issue. So, but in today's context, this is possible, feasible, and there should be some changes to the existing, laws or whatever procedures. Yeah, the locations can be shared with certain organizations, and you can set the level of access to the system. RTA, the unit responsible, can access only those states. So this is the way forward, I think, because then the engineers can attend to these two types of black spots. One is the black spot due to the road geometry and the road design. The other one is the black spot created due to something else, the operation. So this is where we are today. So with the technology, as Engineer Nihal mentioned, we have to be smarter. So it is possible that, and also sometimes, most of these minor accidents are not getting reported to police, because we know that the hassle that you have to go through if you are going to report an crash to the police. So if it is a minor crash, it is better for me to use my insurance or forget about it. So, but in such situations, some insurance will get some information that they can share the location, not the other details. And on top of that, you can create a situation where, if accident happens, the users also can share the location with a photograph. You don't take them to the official record, but you get a flag. This place, there are crashes happening, so that the road authorities can attend to those. I think that is the way forward, and the engineers will have to take some lead in this area.
That elaborates, what has really happened. The first question is what has happened to the decade of action plan and the stakeholder responsibility and so on. I think that's a good introductory point for us to continue the next, session of this seminar. And at the same time, Professor Bandara has mentioned that the attitudes of an engineer has a lot to do with this road safety. I would like to ask from Mr. Amarasekara now, when it comes to the attitude of engineers, of course, we understand now data sharing is not up to the required level. There's a huge gap which we need to, fulfill in the future. But apart from that, when it comes to the attitude of the engineers with respect to the road safety, what do you think? Representing an organization where we produce engineers, I would like to ask, are we producing the right kind of engineers with the right kind of attitudes, especially with the civil engineers having the right kind of attitudes towards the road safety or not? I don't know. That's the question I'm asking. And is there any program from the RDA side to, improve these attitudes, or rather, I would say improve, not rather correct, improve these attitudes towards the road safety and having a more safety sort of a culture? Is there any programs or any activities or any actions being taken from your organization point of view?
Yeah, I may not be able to answer from the Road Development Authority point of view, because I have left the Road Development Authority back. So what's currently happening, maybe I may be outdated sometime. So, but of course, at the time that we took as much as possible to make guidelines road safety control devices and device 1, 2, 3 like that. We prepared guidelines, and then we ensured that those are implemented also during construction and rehabilitation. And then maintenance engineers are always taken to task when things are reported, accidents and maintenance levels. So more than often, under guidance of the senior engineers like provincial director, chief engineer, and these engineers are functioning. And I don't think that there's a very, very high level of negligence from road authority engineers, whether it is provincial council or whether it is road authority. More and more consciousness is there that they have to, they are in charge of it, and they have to do that. Any physical work to be done, that should be done by maintenance engineer if it's a day-to-day affair. So I think they are quite aware. And I don't think that funds have been anyway a problem. Because funds for maintenance funds, they can use it any way they like, because there's no restriction as such to approve, estimate, and it takes time or something. If you decide today, and the maintenance allocations are distributed either beginning of the year or quarterly or whatever it is, so they have a block allocation. They can use it for any incidents like this, but not for major improvement. But of course, any minor improvements that you have to increase the road safety, they're quite geared to do that. So I think young engineers coming in with the guidance of the senior engineers, of course, when they come from the university, they are not fully prepared to go and do that. But of course, with the guidance of the engineers, because a lot of experienced engineers are there in the chief engineer level, provincial director level, they are either more than, when it becomes a chief engineer, they are over 12, 15 years experience. And then when it comes to provincial director, more than 20 years experience. So they are quite aware, and then social responsibility, all that is there. I don't think there's a problem. This is not to say that we have got a full cream of good engineers. So we are having all, they are very, very well motivated, but there may be incidents. But of course, as a general, more than 50%, yes, they shoulder the responsibility. But of course, there is scope for improvement with this introduction of new technology like IT, and then guidelines, and then this sharing of accident reporting, and say, we can do more. There's absolutely there's scope for improving improving the attitudes of these engineers. Like just to add what Mr. Niyal said, this road safety meeting, monthly meeting. In fact, while we were there also, we had this road safety meeting. Of course, we start, it goes for about 6 months. After that, one by one, either police officer is not turning up or other responsible officers are not turning up. So after that, it gets automatically that meeting is not held. So we have started so many times during my career in the field for 26. I would have started more than, it was there in district-wise, it was there in province-wise, it was there in the say division-wise, like that, the police station-wise also we had. They start, but it's not sustained. So this road safety meeting was there. It never sustained. So fortunately, it has sustained in Colombo municipality, maybe due to pressure and things like that. Okay.
You also attend some of the meetings.
That's right. I think I have a question for Mr. Nihal, but before that, we are getting more and more questions in the chat box. So since time also running, I would thought of, you know, asking or rather having one or two questions on board. So I think there's a quick question to Professor Bandara based on the statement that you made. And the question is about, is there any research carried out to prove that accidents happen at the beginning or end of the journey?
Well, there's a lot of literature available on that aspect. Unfortunately, here it's very difficult to do such a research unless you go and ask people, because accident crash data would have that kind of information. But it's a general trend, and not only in the engineering literature, it's in the other areas like the psychology and road safety related other areas. People have highlighted, or they have not proved, but you know, there is the consensus that, you know, the accidents are happening, more probability of accidents happening at the two ends due to some psychological reasons as well, not due to an engineering reason. So why I mentioned it, because the faster one knows, it's at the very early stage of the the trip. Well, the psychological wise, you know, when you have a long trip, you try to meet certain targets. So general trend is that you try to catch up as much as possible at the beginning, and then later on you settle down, right? And then towards the end, either you relax or either you are very stressed, depending on the trip. So those are the reasons given for high probability of accident at you know, the end. So that is not really related to the engineering part. That is human nature, because we need to understand how the human behavior in, you know, road safety, because that is very, very, I mentioned that, you know, any crash, there should be some human error in judgment to accident, you know, crash to happen, right? There can be other situations, but that is the reality.
Yes, you can add on. Yes,
I can add a little bit on that. When we opened up Southern Highway in 2011 from Kottao to Pinnadu, and after some time, I think maybe 2014 or so, with the help of some we carried out some research work. I think it was guided by Professor Mapper when he was doing a consultant. We wanted our other divisions to select a topic and then do various research. This is one of the research that outcome. So I mean, just to do a light of it, we tried where these accidents happens on expressway from Kottayam to Pinnaduvu. Of course, these records we had because we had our control room and the accidents happened. And then when accident happens, our expressway maintenance authority and the management authority, management that division people also go. When we had this accident data, we found that after from Kottayam, within 5 to 10 minutes, lot of accidents has happened between Kahatuduwa that Galanigaon. We found that this place a lot of accidents are happening and it is more than the other place. So this is the beginning of the journey. Within 5 to 10 minutes, some accidents happen. More accidents. We tried to find whether we went to detail whether to find whether there's something wrong in the road geometry. Because very lately we found some slight camber issue, but of course it was not the case. That camber issue would have happened during bad weather, if at all, if there's effect. But we found this so that at the beginning of the trip, this trend was there. So maybe either they are falling asleep or something is happening. There was some more accident within 5 to 10 minutes of coming sort of journey from Pinnaduvu to, when we opened from Kottayam to Pinnaduvu. Just to share that experience.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Amarasekara. Turning towards Mr. Nihal again. Now, there are two, sides now. Mr. Amarasekara from the RDA side is saying, you know, when it comes to the funding, there is no such, you know, big shortage to do the maintenance and, you know, improve the road safety. But when it comes to the CMC, you mentioned that, you know, when it comes to the special projects and so on, there's a limited budget for road safety and sometimes been cut off and so on. So again, coupling with the question came through the chat, I would like to straight away, I'll just mention the question. You had served in CMC for many years. As per your experience, what would be the first measure you would take to improve the road safety with the CMC? So with this funding question and with your experience, I would like to ask this question from you. What do you think? What is your idea?
Is the question for the entire country or
no
is
it we are focused? Talking now it's focused on the Kanamba Municipal Council. He's asking what is the first measure you would take to improve the road safety. You can prioritize some road safety issues rather. What would be the first measure you would take to improve the road safety within CMC? So that's one question, and funding is another question, I would say.
I think Colombo is such that, a lot of speeds cannot be achieved during the daytime, right? Most of the accidents happen in the night. And they are also, what we have found is it's because of drink and driving, where most of the fatalities happen. Anyway, now putting on record what priority, I would ensure pedestrian safety, because most of the pedestrian crossings are very vulnerable. So that's one point. And, I have left 2 years back almost. So at that time, even now, they are giving some attention to lighting up the pedestrian crossings and also, improving the traffic signals. Timing of traffic signals. Now, for an example, Duplication Road, when that was rehabilitated, that was made one way, as you know. And one of the biggest challenge was the Pelican crossings, because they are one way, it's very vulnerable for accidents. People just can't cross three lanes, and we had to put Pelican crossings. And there are one of the issues that we had was everybody presses during the peak time the traffic signal, the Pelican crossing, and the whole flow gets interrupted. So that time this Google speeds were not available. We even spoke to people like Dialogue, whether they can extract that, but that was Now, of course, you have Google Speeds, you know, you can, you know, adjust the timing so that, you know, the total flow does not get interrupted, whilst ensuring that, you know, the pedestrians also will have some safer time to cross. So, I would give more priority to pedestrians, because it's mostly you see, you know, pedestrians, you know, car-to-car accident, you know, if you look at the statistics, not very fatal. But, you know, I mean, you can run over a pedestrian, so I will give priority to pedestrian.
I think that is quite right, and I really in agreement with your answer, because when we look at the crash data and, I mean, analyzing the crash data, we have come across, you know, there are a lot of pedestrian-related accidents are taking place when you're talking about Colombo municipal area, because one reason could be maybe due to the congestion and a lot of vehicles are in the Colombo city, the speeds are less. As a result, the fatalities are, I mean, somewhat less compared to the crashes that has happened in the suburban and rural places. And on top of that, road network is fairly, I would say, up to a good standard, and, you know, there are less deviation, less maintenance work, and less, I think, disturbance to the traffic. So vehicle-to-vehicle crashes or single-vehicle crashes, number of crashes are less, as well as the severities are less. So I think pedestrian, focusing on pedestrian would be the ideal solution in that case. Even I'm in the agreement. Okay, thank you very much. So with that, I think I have another question from the audience again going towards Mr. Amarasekhar. There are two questions, actually. I just summarized it into one. Basically, it talks about the super elevation. So it basically says super elevation in the hill country roads. One suggests that that can be the reason for the passer accidents. You can give an answer on that. Or generally, another person says super elevation is not available in roads, especially in the hill country, and it leads to some dangerous situations. What is your answer to that question?
These are rehabilitated roads. These super elevations have been taken into account while designing, and then definitely it is there. If it is not a rehabilitated road, then of course, yes, there may be a problem, because these are constructed a long time back, and over again, these metal and rubber roads, there could have been design errors and things like that. But until you do the rehabilitation, you can't. These rehabilitated roads, definitely those geometric concerns have been done, and it was supervised by a supervision consultant for implementation of designs. So that I have not visited this place particularly, and I have not seen to myself, so I can't vouch for sure what happened. But of course, definitely we take into account these super elevations and the precautions required while doing the reconstruction and the improvement of the road. So this particular road section from Badulla to Pasara, Pasara to Lonugala, these are under improvement, and definitely these super elevation and all these geometric features have been taken into account. That for sure.
Okay, so in that case, there is no connection between the Pasara accident and the super elevation. That has nothing to do with it. Okay, in your opinion, that's fine. Okay, I think another question to Professor Bandara. Now it says, this is about the signalized intersections, and it says signalized intersections in Colombo having conflicting signals, and sometime caution given in written only in English. So I think the question is about the messages has been given, you know, there are warning messages is given, you know, there are warning signs and boards, and I think those messages are given only in English. That could be the problem, if I'm not mistaken, you know, I mean, that's how I can see from the comment. But anyway, so the main question is, I think in the signalized intersections, there are conflicting signals, and any comment on that, Professor Bandara, and adding more about the language issue?
In traffic, signals and signs, language shouldn't be a media to tell anything important. Those are additional things. The sign or the light or the marking tell exactly what to do. That is the accepted way of doing. But you know, in some instances, you know, over and above, you know, some messages may have been placed. That's a different story. But I don't think that, you know, unless there is some software issue, there cannot be conflicting signal at the fixed thickness, because when you come up with a processor, you have to have those incorporated where, you know, you cannot have conflicting signals at the same time, unless, you know, due to rain and, you know, something happened to the circuit. It cannot happen, because it's by nature the processors are developed in that way. But I think, you know, they may be referring to what Engineer Nihal mentioned about the arrow and the solid grain. A lot of people do not know the difference. Arrow means you have the priority. Solid grains means you have to give way for others, unless, you know, you are going straight. So that some places may be due to lack of knowledge of the people who are really working in the field, may have, you know, mixed up. The place where you have to give a green, solid green, arrow may have been given. That was there, I think, at Kasubatta. I think I mentioned to Samarasekhar sometimes back, you know, to left turn, when the pedestrians are there, you can't have arrow. Yeah, so, but it was changed. But now the timing was also changed. But other than that, we cannot have a conflict. But now there is a trend where non-standard facing arrangements have been made. You get red, green, and then amber flashes. So you don't know what to do. So that may have done because you can't really coordinate, you know, too close by signal. But from the user point of view, you don't know what to do, because those are not standard. So there are some places which, not in CMC area, but outside, has that kind of situation. And also, certain places, you know, pedestrian signals have been used to control intersection partly. That is also, certain places, it is confusing, because they are not standard. And also, if you go to the cassette, how the signal heads arrangement and what we are practicing has some differences. Both RDA and CMC practice differently, but what is in the cassette is totally different. So that is the issue, I think. So I suggested long time back to have some standardization, because later on we will run into problems, because the cassette says one, RDA practice one, CMC practice both, vertical, horizontal, and we should be. Now RDA now, so these are, there are certain issues related to that. Other than that, you know, there cannot be conflicting movements allowed unless, you know, there's something seriously wrong, because the processor itself is designed not to have that. But with the pedestrians, it's possible with this arrow and the solid green confusion. And just add to the earlier question about the funding. Now, actually, no any stakeholder organization get separate budget line item to call road safety. Now you, if I can remember, until recently there was no. So So RDE had to manage with the maintenance funds to do road safety. But it was one of the suggestions under action plan to have a separate budget item so that you can attend to road safety. If it has been done, good. But it has to be there for all the organizations, not only for RDE. Otherwise, we have to manage with something else.
I guess Mr. Amarasekhar wants to add something.
Yeah, I wanted just add about the conflicting signals. I think I came across this problem, and we were consciously doing it, as he correctly said, in the signal in a signalized junction, the left turn and the pedestrian crossing signals are given together, and then as he said correctly, it is given not the arrow, it is given the solid green. So that and then also later we had to put up a board also, say that be careful of the pedestrians. So I think this may be the one they are telling that it's on English, and you can't have three languages there. And we consciously put that one because you can't have put up a big board. So consciously be careful of the pedestrians. But that message is already there. If he is a good driver and if he is conversant with the traffic code, then he should know. He is not given full way to pass through. He had to see whether any pedestrians are going, and then he had to give priority for those people to cross and then go. So just to remind that pedestrians has the priority there, and this at the left turn. Otherwise, now this signal timing, the cycle time will get increased unacceptably. If you give if you close the traffic also and then give a separate signal timing for pedestrian also. Along with the left turn, then signal timing is going to be very high, and you can't manage that one. Then there will be a lot of queues. Signal timing maybe 2, 3, 4 minutes till you might not be able to adjust the timing. So this pedestrian crossing, pedestrian movement, and the left turn is given together. So they may be telling that it's conflicting, but it's not conflicting if we identify this solid green. It's not warrant for him to pass through. He has to see that there's no obstruction. So this is, I think, not thought well, and it has to be well stressed in driver training, I think.
That's right. I think that directly goes to the driver training and maybe testing at the point of license issuing as well, I guess. So coming back to the main point again, I think there's a question saying, is there any black spot survey done by RDE or any other authority? Before asking this question from Mr. Amarasekhar, I would like to add a little bit onto this, and from my personal experience, we've been involved in road safety audits and the black spot analysis when RDE was rehabilitating the Gold Road as well as the Nigambu Road. We did an extensive study, you know, looking at what are the black spots, what needs to be corrected, and so on. And I think that has came up very well. I think now road is up to a very good standard, and we can see very less accidents and so on. And we have corrected, I would say, many of the prevailing issues. But apart from that, has RDE done, has RDE doing a routine black spot investigation sort of thing? Has RDE done any studies with respect to identifying black spots in the road network in Sri Lanka?
Yes, we do. And then while doing the rehabilitation, we do the feasibility study at that stage. This road safety audit is a must. Even now, rural roads improved under iRoad program. There again, we do this road safety audit, and then we attend to those black spots. And National Road Master Plan, we prepared one from 2007 to 2017. Now they have already issued the final draft of 2017 to 2027. There again, they have identified this black spot. As much as possible, they have incorporated. But this must be a what you call ongoing one. Then one time you do the surveys and then find out and then suggest solution, and then you are not conscious that newly created black spots are ongoing. So as I said, because accident data is not shared, it's not currently happening the way that we would like to have.
Yeah, I think there's a big room that we have to improve, I think, from the engineer's point of view. to do these things. Data is of course required, and there should be a proper mechanism to do it at very frequent times, I would say. Anyway, next question to Mr. Actually, I mean, anybody can answer to this question, but I would like to ask especially from Mr. Nihal, because the question is about the code and standards for traffic. This is from the audience again. It says, do we have a code or standard for traffic? And if I elaborate, I mean, as I can get it. The second question says, Sri Lanka traffic code is well written, but no one observed those. So I would like to ask a question in this way. You know, is there a code of conduct, code of, I would say, is there a standard in the traffic? How to behave in the road. So, I mean, it comes under the rules and regulations, but is there any specific code or anything?
The question,
is not really very clear.
Little confusing. That's right. To give a fair answer, you know, I mean, there are standards for doing the designs, you know, when you install a traffic signal, for an example, then when you design the signal timing, then when you design the all red timing, you know, there are standards. There are, if you miss that, you know, you can have a catastrophic issue. For an example, now if you have all red time, looking at the geometry of the intersection, and if you get that wrong, you know, two people coming in opposite direction, you know, somebody who is trying to pass through in the last second, you know, you might have accident. So there are standards, but having said that, you know, Colombo is an urban situation, especially Colombo city limits. There could be compromises, but definitely the safety is ensured. Definitely safety is ensured. Now look, from the driver's side, operator's side, you know, there is a standard that, you know, everybody has to follow as drivers and pedestrians, right? You know, as a pedestrian, you're not supposed to, you know, have a phone on your ear and, you know, walk, right? You know, must be careful, and, you know, you must be very abrupt, you know, as to process fast as you can. Not to run, but at least within a reasonable time. Everybody has a responsibility in that, you know, a shared responsibility. So that's my answer to.
I think it's very clear. I think it's a shared responsibility. There is no doubt about it. But since today's discussion is more focused towards the engineer's responsibility, I would like to put more blame onto the engineer side. And let me ask another question in addition to the what I asked, or based on the answer that we have given. Now, when you're talking about the engineering standards, I have seen in Colombo, there are traffic lights. I would say substandard traffic lights are installed in Colombo. I don't think, I mean, it's the right way to do it. For example, if I explain more, there are traffic signals, you know, there's a primary head, but there is no secondary head. So at the stop line, right at the stop line, the light is on top of you. So if you're at the front, if you're the first person to stop at the stop line, you can't really see the light. There is no secondary post. And then there's a great difficulty. I mean, even I have came across, you know, this, and there are common places if I wanted to quote, you know, I don't want to right now. But I believe that is a substandard installation. I don't know why it has happened. Any answer to that?
Well, these are some of the installations that have taken place long time back. You know, if you take the history, I think Colombo Municipal Council started installing the traffic signals, but over the years they have been refurbished. Now, if you see the new installations, adequate visibility on the overhead line. Mostly, I agree, but some of the previous installations does not have the required primary and the secondary, setting back the stop line and things like that, you know.
Professor Bandar, would you like to share any experience?
I think most of the places, I think 99%, we have the secondary, but there can be about 10-15% locations where the secondary cannot be seen due to some other issue. Maybe a signboard, maybe a tree, a branch, something like that. So those situations are there. But generally, you know, there is a secondary somewhere.
You get a lot of urban trees, and you know, tree branches can, you know, be obstruction. You know, some of the, you tell the right place, but the installer might go and install the traffic, you know, the signboard, so that, you know, from a distance you can't see the. It's been corrected continuously, but you know, I'm not trying to wash off saying that, you know, we are perfect. Nobody's perfect, but there are issues. But they have been constantly addressed. Anyway, I'm no in the council, but you know, that's how I hope the present people are also doing.
Okay, thank you. Again, Mr. Amarasekar, now there's another question saying, suggest to implement a simple mechanism to communicate with general public. It is an awareness issue. I think all three of you can give an answer to this. So even I believe it's a communication with general public. There are certain times you can see the construction work going on, certain times you can see the maintenance work going on, and sometimes the proper detour, traffic management plans are not really, I mean, sometimes it's implemented, but it's not really known to the public. Public is not really aware of it, and as a result, congestion takes place, and it leads to road safety issues. Most of the time you can see, and the night times you can see, I mean, there are problems related to this. So awareness seems to be a good issue. What do you think? I mean, has RDA taken any steps towards, you know, having more awareness, you know, about these things? And talk about this context?
Elaborate. The communication has been improved with, I mean, like Expressway, the 1969 or something. There's hotline for toll-free hotline for RDA also, RDA and the ministry. There it's operated 24 hours. Anybody wants to complain, anybody wants to take information, like water board, electricity, there's a hotline. So they, it is 1968, if I'm not mistaken. So that is there. That has been established a long time back, maybe 7 years ago. So they can communicate. This is available. And also website is there. The complaint systems are also being implemented now. We have implemented in the projects where people can complain and complaints are received, and then they will receive a reply also. They can use a mobile and make complaints, and then they can follow up whether it is answered or not. It's implemented in our iRoad program. I think it is communicated. I mean, it has been implemented with the other projects also now. This is a complaints management system. For RDA, there's a hotline, 1968, I think. So there again, they can complain or communicate any issues related to public. So other than that, the website is there. And then all the telephone numbers of the divisions, and then regional divisions, all that is there. So they can make a complaint or clarifications they can obtain.
From the context of CMC, do we think the awareness to the public with respect to the traffic management, I mean, when it comes to, again, road maintenance and so on, is adequate at the moment?
Colombo, you know, if it is an excavation or a detour, you have to get the permission from the traffic, EIG traffic, even if you are doing something, some work of that nature. I wouldn't say there are major detours that take place in Colombo, but excavations can happen, you know, but the mechanism of work being done in particular road, I don't think the message doesn't go to the public, but you know, if it is a closure of a road, you know, you have to you announce them quite early, so that, you know, people will know. But day-to-day maintenance, you know, utility agencies excavating roads to lay their utilities, that kind of a thing, you know, if it is not a major concern, in the sense major obstruction to the traffic, then it is not disseminated to the public.
Okay. Once again, I would like to ask from Professor Bandara. Now, when it comes to work zones, especially in national roads, and I mean, not only national roads, in other class of roads as well. When it comes to road zones, and many accidents have been taken place, not only in Sri Lanka, in many other countries as well. And there are many studies that have been done, you know, especially looking at work zone related crashes. Can you tell us a little bit on that aspect? You know, I mean, what are the prevailing problems in Sri Lanka with respect to the work zones, especially the road safety, how the road safety has been maintained?
Well, I think RDA has a very comprehensive set of guidelines and the signs and the markings for work zones. But depending on the project, the level of implementation can vary. That depends on the contractor who is doing the work. Sometimes you have to remind him about certain things. But overall, I think all the procedures, the signs and markings are well established, and it's just a matter of following it. The problem is that in certain situations, you need to control and, you know, stop one lane and allow the other lane to go. And that situation, you know, sometimes very few drivers, they are impatient and, you know, try and create unnecessary, you know, blockage to the path. Yeah, you know, you have to then negotiate a very risky movement to get out of it. So these are some of the issues because the flagmans are there, but, you know, sometimes people won't really adhere to those signs. Very often what happens is, you know, the first vehicle stops. There's another vehicle, you know, try to overtake and come and stop there, then the outflow gets blocked. And in such situation, you know, there can be some minor accident, not major accident. But there are certain situations during night when the work is not going on. If there are any lapses and there can be some serious accidents. Maybe due to, you know, they really don't consider the warning signs at the beginning. Because now, something that I would like to highlight is that, you know, we usually what we do is we go and find people. If you travel at, you know, 75 kilometers per hour in a section where, you know, you can even travel at 80, 90 kilometers per hour. But other countries, you know, if there's a work zone, it is 40, you know, if you go at 45, you get fine. Not the other. Very high speed also you have to. But there are certain things that we need to change our culture. Mm-hmm. So especially you have to monitor the speed at the workplace. So if drivers know that, you know, in these areas, you know, you are going to get monitored, definitely these problems will go down, especially during the night time where the work is not happening. I think, you know, again, you know, it comes to that speed regulation. So we need to have a better, you know, logical and scientific way of doing it rather than, you know, try to have maximize the number of tickets to be issued. So if there are places, yeah, you know, frequently high speed tickets are issued, that has to be communicated to the road authority to correct it. there is an issue, right? Not continue with the same design and, you know, continue to give the ticket. So that's what my you know, thinking. So we have to, you know, enforce rules and regulations at work zone, especially during night. When work is going on, you know, people are careful. I think Thomas Baker will be able to add to that.
Yeah, I think let me disturb a little bit, Mr. Amarasekhar. Of course, we need your opinion. And before that, I would like to add something to the question as well. Because I have seen if I quote example in Jaffna, when there was this construction going on, actually the structures, you know, culverts and so on, there were many accidents that has happened. There were detour roads and so on, but at the negligence of basically the engineer, you know, because no proper barricades were there, no proper signs were there, no proper lighting was there at night, warning signs and so on. Nothing was there, but unfortunately, people have, you know, ended up with fatal accidents, single crash accidents, I mean, single vehicle accidents, I would say. But unfortunately, when it comes to the databases, it's been reported as a drunken driving situation, because it could be, I mean, user has contributed as well, because probably they are drunk and, you know, so on, and they put the reason as drunken driving. But we all know there's a, you know, another story behind it. And even though they are drunk, you know, we would have saved their life, not fatal. So with that, I would like to ask from Mr. Amarasekhar, do you really, I would say, do you think the work zone safety measures are adequate at the present context, and what is our way forward?
This is one of the areas to be improved for certain. And as Professor Bandara said, all the codes, everything available, and we conduct training programs, and at the beginning of the project, we make awareness program, all that. With all that, continuous work zone management is very poor. If I to give marks out of 100, it may be in the range of 30-40, not enough. Now, of course, it's better than earlier. They maintain at least it's passable. Earlier in the work zone, it is not passable also. It is very uncomfortable to pass. They don't take care of at all until the construction. Of course, that part is looked after, and maintaining the signs, lighting, and ensure that those things are there during the night and then weekends and like that. That is poor. It's not enough. So this is one of the area that they have to improve. Work zone management is poor. This is one of the area that we have to take up with the consultant, with the engineers, and then ensure that it is implemented. And now that Candy Road also is going to get improved, I think they're going to start from Patsala to Candy. This is one of the area that I think now they have to concentrate very much. Work zone management, because it's a long stretch and a lot of vehicles are going. So I think this is one of the area that they have to pick up. There's a lot of scope for improvement. All the materials are there, but implementation issue is there with the, they have to do it right at the beginning, and they'll have to keep on maintaining it until the project is over. So it is poor. I accept that is, and we have tried many a times conducting training, awareness programs, all that, but still it's not up to the mark. There's a lot of improvement. I accept that, yeah. Not only in RDA sites, but all the sites.
Okay. I think I should ask the same question from Mr. Nihal as well. Anyway, he has mentioned this before in his previous statements, and I would like to ask a quick. I would like to have a quick answer from you regarding these work zones in the Colombo Municipal Council area, especially with the new projects. For example, if I quote one, there's an ongoing project, probably, I mean, not really involved, but you know, I mean, there's a sewer line installment, I think, going on along the baseline road and so on. And there's a deep excavation, you know, has been undertaken, and at night you can see very limited cover. You know, just cover surrounding the dig area. But if a vehicle comes and hit it, you know, obviously probably it could be not a large vehicle. If it is a small car or a motorcycle, probably, you know, could have gone in. So, and, you know, create another fatal accident. And how we can correct this? And of course, we can see there's a problem. How we can correct this?
I would say safety is not the perfect thing in work zones. as you mentioned rightly, and correcting is that is also a daunting task. Unless otherwise, you inculcate, you know, inbuilt something to the contract. That's what in my previous speech also I said. I have managed contracts, and it's very difficult, extremely difficult, because you know whatever the money that has been put in as safety measures are very much less, and if, even if you don't pay that, you know they're not bothered because it's a minor component that gets you know chopped off. So I think the new contracts, you know, with this current trend, I think it's timely that, you know, we incorporate some punitive action and also to make sure that, you know, they nobody can bid anything below engineer's estimate specified in the for safety. So that, you know, there is a study that is taken place, and also, you know, just people can't just underquote. So that's the correct way. So I think there is a lot of space for correcting and improving. But having said that, over the years, things have improved a lot, but there is still more scope to improve.
Thank you very much. I think we have almost come to the end of this session, and I have actually a lot more questions in my hand. And since this is not the end of this discussion, we have more discussions coming on in the same topic, you know, in the future, so we can keep them for the future. But there are many questions actually about user behavior and maybe the enforcement side and so on. Unfortunately, we invited actually the former DIG, but he couldn't make it today. But in future, I hope he will join this discussion so I can keep these questions for him. And there are many other questions, general questions to all of you, but which, again, we can keep it for the future. But as a last round of question, I would like to again start from this end. I would like to ask, in your opinion, what IESL can do? What is the contribution can be given from IESL as a very responsible organization to improve the engineer's responsibility towards road safety? What can what can we do basically? What is your answer on that?
I think building an institutional culture is the most important thing, because now I don't see that, you know, sometimes you try, now for an example, in the budget, right? For safety, you include a lot of things, right? So what we used to get is we ask about 150 million for some items. Then end of the day, when the budget book comes later on after improving, you know, it's bracketed and half is given, right? So that's what I say, you know, institutional culture build up, you know, you can train engineers, but they, you know, you can tell the IESL can, you know, have conduct so many class, you know, sessions, you know, how to improve that, you know, all that can be done. But then, I mean, if the institutional culture is not there, then it's a problem. And also, you know, as seniors, you know, a lot of people, the boss, right? So if the boss do things, you know, others also will follow. You ask the same question about young seniors. So I think senior people must set the goals, you know, for the new coming people. So that's my short answer to that.
Yeah, let me ask another quick question on that. Now, can you suggest a very, I would say, specific measure, very specific, I would say, action, which can be taken by IESL to improve this? When it comes to, because you are talking continuously about the budget shortages and, you know, things like that, how we can contribute towards improving that? Can you suggest anything very straightforward? I hope it's not a really hard question.
That's a bit difficult, honestly. Anyway.
Or maybe you can think.
I think right into the organizations as the core body here, you know, to pay more attention, to give a better weight for road safety. I think that might have some implication, or legally, you know, make the organizations like the RDA, who maintains roads, compulsory that, you know, they allocate certain amount of money, and the mechanism, you know, if you tell, okay, go and you know do safety audit, and if the cadre doesn't provide recruitment, you know, you just simply can't do that, right? So now, for an example, asset management. You know how much you know emphasis is given by the organizations, right? You know, however you try to you know ask for people of that nature, it's very difficult because always cut down, and you know people who come to assess the cadre every 3 years, like you know they have absolutely no experience, or you know I mean they don't know what's going on, and they just come to cut and go, you know. So that's what I say, you know, I mean, if the institutional culture is built up, it's a different task. It's a different ball game altogether, right? So if the institution is held responsible, then from the top of the institution, you know, he is also responsible, then it will come down. So this is my thinking, the way that, you know, to correct it, I don't know that I've given the right answer. Anyway.
Okay, I think I would like to go towards Mr. Amarasekhar now. I mean, can you give an answer to the same question? What IESL can do basically to improve the road safety, you know, I mean, with respect to the engineers, I would say, what you can expect, what as RD, as a big organization, can expect from IESL to do?
I think in many ways, IESL can intervene. This is one of the programs that you have already started. I think this is a good scheme. It's eye-opener. And then we have to make the engineers' fraternity aware.
More awareness.
This is one of the, we can keep constantly reminded that there's a responsibility towards the society that we have to do everything possible to improve the road safety. But I know, the safety is engineering, education, enforcement, all that together. But we are talking about the roads and then some of the traffic purposes, what is not improved. Now, roads have been improved since of 2005 or something. They have improved quite a lot, and then surface have been improved, signing and marking has improved, all that happened, and engineering like traffic control devices, all that has been improved. But when it comes to education, like driver training, and then improving their skills, they may be testing whether they can drive, but it's not enough. I think if they are testing 1 hour for driver testing, they must test 1 week for whether they have, and there must be specific hours of training for attitude changes, and then conversant with the road signs and marking and first aid, all that. So that has not improved at all. I think that is one of the area that I think we have to, engineers fraternity have to
maybe reinforce.
Yeah, reinforced, and then we can prepare things. This should happen this way. And then give it to the responsible people. This is something that you have to implement. But they have just set up a set of questions and maybe five sets and repeated all the time. I think they can by memory, they can answer all the questions. What is there in the database? But it's not enough. But with our IT knowledge and our experienced engineers, we can prepare things like the guidance for improvement of the driver training. And also, the new technology, it doesn't absorb or it doesn't come up its own to these road authorities, the new technology and the available IT enhancement, intelligent transport. I think these things like regular seminars and webinars, you can draw the attention of these road authorities so that at least few out of the 100 might get implemented down the line.
Okay. Professor Vandara, may I know your answer as well?
Yes. One is that, you know, what engineer Nia's problem of, BOQ item and the amount. Because if you increase, the net result will be the project cost will increase. So we have to come up with some mechanism. I think IESL also can get involved. Some kind of incentive scheme. Because otherwise, you know, you quote very high and then, you know, you save that. So only you can claim or you will be reimbursed depending on your performance. Because otherwise, you know, you put a very high value, the project cost go up. And there can be other repercussions. So whether you can have some kind of a incentive mechanism for recovery. Because if your safety is bad, you know, you won't get anything. If your safety is good, you know, you will get it back, you know, you will be paid for the full amount or something like that. Because otherwise what will happen is, you know, you just put high value and nothing will happen. And when it comes to the organization, so I just tell very particular about accreditation of universities and the courses. Why not have something for organization, not accreditation, but at least at the exhibition, you know, can we have something on road safety achievement and, you know, give award for organization? Even RDA can have, you know, different provincial directors or different sections can come up. This is what we have done or we are going to do, some innovation related to road safety, right? So not only RDA, EMC, Water Board, CED, all these people can tell, you know, something that they have done new to improve road safety. I think, you know, that's kind of an incentive type of mechanisms we may have to implement rather than, you know, rules and regulations, because it's, the people will think, you know, it's a, you know, something type of difficult. And also, if an engineer come for professional interview, right, if they are from an organization related to road, you can have one or two questions on it. Or either at least to tell what they are thinking about it. Then they at least they have to come prepared, rather than asking the reinforcement and, you know, the design. You can ask about the safety of that design. At least one question. You know. Then everybody knows that, you know, at the professional interview, safety is also checked.
I think there
are some. Yeah, these are some things that I can.
I think from all three answers, I can see there's a clear evidence that the safety culture has to be developed from the, I mean, institution itself as well. You know, that's where the ISL can also contribute. I think we have come to an end of today's discussion, and we don't have much time to proceed. And I think we had good, fruitful 2 hours of discussion, and we are willing to continue this in the future in different directions and so on. And more detailed discussions, I would say, and which will give more awareness to the engineers as well as the, I mean, basically engineers, I would say. And thank you very much for all the panel members for taking part in this conversation and the session, I would say. And thank you very much for the members who have joined to this webinar and giving us a lot of questions. And I hope we have given good answers. I think panel members have given good answers to your questions. And we would like to continue this session, I mean, this series of sessions, I would say, and we'll let you know through the web mails and so on. And thank you very much. And with that, we'll conclude the session. Thank you.